Okay, we've gone over a lot of examples of linear transformations. Now we're going to talk about a particular kind of linear transformations. We're going to talk about linear transformations in Euclidean space. So these are things that are mapping Rn to Rm. And the big deal about them is that every linear transformation in Euclidean space is multiplication by a matrix. Now we saw a whole bunch of other examples like projections and rotations and shears and all kinds of crazy geometric maneuvers, and they didn't look like matrix multiplication. But in fact, no matter what the linear transformation is, as long as it's from Rn to Rm, there is a matrix such that the linear transformation is just multiplication by that matrix. And the name for that matrix, not surprisingly, is the matrix of the linear transformation. So let's see why that works. Now for that, we'll need a little bit of notation. So in Rn, let's define some vectors. We'll define our basis vectors. E1 is just the vector 1, 0, 0, and so on. And E2 is 0, 1, 0, and so on. And in general, Ek is going to have a 1 in the kth slot and a 0 in every other slot. That means that if you have a vector x, which is x1, x2, through xn, well, that's x1 times e1 plus x2 times e2 all the way up to xn times en. Okay, and now we're going to apply the rules of our linear transformation. We want to figure out what is L of x. Well, that's L of x1, e1, plus xn, en. And by the rules of a linear transformation, L applied to a sum of vectors is just the sum of L applied to each vector. So that's L applied to x1, e1, plus L applied to x2, e2, all the way up to L applied to xn, en. And now we use our rules again. L applied to a multiple of e1 is a multiple of L applied to e1. And now we recognize something. When do you get a linear combination of vectors whose coefficients are x1, x2 through xn? Well, that's exactly what happens when you take a matrix whose columns are L of e1 through L of en, and you multiply it by x1 through xn. That's what matrix multiplication is. It's a linear combination of the columns of the matrix whose entries are the coefficients of the vectors. So lo and behold, we've proven our theorem and we've derived a formula for our matrix. So let's do an example of using this to get a geometric operation described as a matrix. So let's suppose that we're working in going from R2 to R2. And we're thinking of R2 as the usual plane, and we have the usual notions of lengths and angles, you know, basically the plane to itself. And let's suppose that L is rotation by an angle theta, counterclockwise. Okay, so if you pick your favorite angle, 37 degrees or something. So here we have our plane, and we start off with the vectors E1 and E2, and we rotate things until we get new vectors L of E1 and L of E2. And these are just, you know, these are orthogonal to each other. They both are unit length, and they're just rotated by an angle theta. So if we can figure out what L of E1 is, we'll have the first column of our matrix. If we can figure out what L of E2 is, we'll have the second column of our matrix. Put them together, and we'll have our matrix. So now we have to do a little bit of trig. So we have, here's L of E1, and it has length 1. And here's our axis, x-axis, and here's our angle theta. So this must be cosine theta, and this must be sine theta. So L of E1 is cosine theta, sine theta. To figure out L of E2, we do a little bit more trig. Here's our y-axis. Here's our vector L of E2. And here's our angle theta. So this distance is cosine theta, and this distance is sine theta. So that means that the coordinates of L of E2, well, its x-coordinates is minus sine theta, because we're going to the left, and its y-coordinate is cosine theta. So now we've got our matrix. Our matrix is L of E1, L of E2, and that's cosine theta, sine theta, minus sine theta, cosine theta. If you ever want to rotate a vector by an angle theta, just multiply it by this matrix.